What is available fault current? All right, so we hear this term, available fault current, constantly. If you're on the Facebook forums or, you know, just talking to people in general, maybe they had a journeyman's exam or master exam or something, and they were like, this available fault current thing is something I keep coming across. Or maybe you're just out in the field and your boss gives you this placard and he's like, hey, you're at a commercial building, we need to put the AFC placard onto a service. In commercial, in other than dwelling services, we have to actually mark what the available fault current for that service is. So what does that even mean? All right, first, let's break out the handy dandy 2020 National Electrical Code. Go into the definitions, and we have fault current and fault, ground fault. So what do all these things mean, first of all? Let's just talk about what a fault is. Fault is basically an accidental occurrence. Like, in a tennis match or something. I don't know, I don't watch tennis, but I feel like I've heard the term fault before. But fault is just like, oops, that's not supposed to happen. So code defines a fault current as the current delivered at a point on the system during a short circuit condition. So not a ground fault, not where a hot's touching a ground, specifically a short circuit, but we can have a ground fault. It's still an oops or an accidental. It's just a ground fault is what we call when a hot touches ground or when it grounds out. We don't call that a short circuit. A short circuit is talking about the actual circuit where there's current flowing to a load. So a short circuit happens between hot conductors, you know, ungrounded conductors, or a hot and a neutral, right? So like the ungrounded and the grounded conductor. So when we're looking at short circuit current, or a short circuit is a type of fault, it's just not a ground fault. There's also arc faults. So arcing can happen between two conductors. We have series arcs where we have like a break in a wire or at like a terminal where we've landed something on a terminal. In series, it can arc. So that's a type of fault that causes a breaker to trip. We could have a parallel arc, which is between two actual ungrounded conductors or between two, like an ungrounded and a grounded. So between two hots or between hot and neutral. It is taking a short cut. It's basically the same thing as a short circuit. It's just an arc that's happening between two conductors rather than a direct short where they're touching each other. So those are the kinds of faults that you might come across and what they actually mean. So what does code say about available fault current? So available fault current, or AFC, is the largest amount of current capable of being delivered at a point on the system during a short circuit condition. So we're talking about a short circuit condition. What is the largest amount of current that can flow during a short circuit at an electrical service? The reason we put that is the closest point to the transformer. So from the transformer, we have our secondary conductors that come in, they attach to our service entrance conductors, come into the service, and boom, they land on our breaker. Everything from the breaker out can still have short circuits and ground faults and everything like that, but the amount of available fault current is gonna be based off of a couple factors, and one of them is the conductor size. How much current can travel through a tiny conductor versus a large one? A whole lot more current can go through a large conductor. So the availability for current to travel, the amount of current that can travel on a fault condition in a small conductor that's way out in the field hooked up to like a toaster or something like that, there's not much available fault current that can happen compared to the amount of current that can flow in these service entrance conductors. Imagine at a service coming off a transformer, we're hooking up like parallel 500s. I mean, we're talking like multiple massive conductors on per phase and then phase to neutral. So when we figure out our available fault current, we're basically saying at this service, if these two incoming hot conductors line to line, not necessarily line to neutral, line to line, the most amount of current would happen between two hots, not a hot and a neutral, because we have double the voltage between two hots where we only have a single amount of voltage between hot and neutral. So the available fault current is always a line to line measure of if these two hots touch here, what is that current? How much current is going to be allowed to flow in this bit of wire from the breaker or wherever, you know, essentially from the breaker if they were to short out at the terminals back to the transformer? so much current is gonna flow so much more than any other point on the system because the conductors are the largest. You probably have a certain amount of length from the service, so that's another thing to figure out is how long are the conductors, because the impedance or the opposition to current flow in conductors, the longer the conductor is, the more material there is for opposition to happen. So naturally you have resistance in, or impedance. I'm just gonna call it resistance for ease of understanding. But the amount of resistance or impedance that you can have in a conductor is going to increase with the length of that conductor. So the how close you are to a transformer, what the let through current of that transformer is, what the voltage is, whether or not it's single phase or three phase, and the size of those conductors are all gonna determine how much current can flow if these two huge conductors just touch each other. That's what available fault current is, and you have to figure that out for every service that's not a residential service. So typically three phase environments, maybe not three phase, but just commercial environments, industrial stuff like that. So then if we look into 110.24 talks about available fault current and field marking of these panels. So what it says, 110.24A says field marking, service equipment at other than dwellings, so not houses, shall be legibly marked in the field with the available fault current. The field marking or markings shall include the date the fault current calculation was performed and be of sufficient durability to withstand the environment involved. So like a placard or something that's not gonna like rub off. The calculation shall be documented and made available to those authorized to design, install, inspect, maintain, and operate the system. And then B goes into modifications. So even if you modify a service, you still have to update the available fault current calculation and put the date and all of that stuff on it. So that is available fault current. Hope that answered some of your questions. Please leave comments below. Any other questions, things that you want me to do videos on. I am spending all of this year, 2022, going through the comments and just answering your guys' stuff because holy hell, over the 5 or 6 years that I've been doing this now, there's been so many suggestions that I can't keep up. So I've been loving doing this, but please ask any of your questions below. Love you crazies, and I'll see you in the next one. Discount music and video.